welcome back. Interestingly enough, I find that at lower speeds, I like to have the camera facing into the train, and at higher speeds, I like to have the camera facing out of the train. Almost time for departure. I was in a AEM7 or a ACS64, I could do 110. So consider that a one-time transient in this train. And we'll try not to do stuff like that again. Devastation that was simulated there. Of course, it was a lot worse than what actually ended up happening. What happened there was a little bit of radioactive air was released to the environment because of hydrogen buildup in the containment building. And they haven't determined anything scientific in terms of any damage to the environment or cancers and other things like that. So kind of inconclusive. elusive of whether or not it caused any damage to the environment or to animals, but it definitely did melt down to the extent that is simulated, which basically you see all sorts of radiation, green flames, and stuff like that as you go by there. It's a very cartoonish depiction. There's never anyone on that. Not even Chernobyl. Is the last view we'll get of the Susquehanna River Valley. As we're starting to enter Pennsylvania Dutch country, my next station should be one of those. station, Lancaster, is at milepost 67 in the simulation. And we're due there at 1:35. We're going to try to make up some time.
Thank you.
skip Downington. Exton is the next station at 207. Might be the Atglen branch. Forget which. No, because we're not. We didn't pick that one up yet. I think it's the Lebanon branch. Because we've picked that up, we've now essentially almost doubled the train traffic going through this corridor, so we've transitioned back to a four-track. There's actually three Pennsylvania railroad routes that go through this region. Two converge back at Lancaster, but I think it's the Atlin branch to the south, and then the main line, and then the north is the Lebanon branch. those of you who don't know, the Strasbourg Railroad is a historical railroad that exists in concert with the Railroad Museum in Pennsylvania. Basically, all of the Northeast Corridor trains, even new ones, well, not new ones, but even recent ones, like the AEM7, are located there once they are retired. And you can ride a steam train on the Strasbourg Railroad. And they'll come out to, come all the way out to where we saw leave in place there on that one. And that's where they'll turn the engine around. And if you're sitting there and you're lucky, you'll see an Amtrak train whiz by at 90 miles an hour. So this is Gap right here. is a relatively new station, like Metro Park, and thus it does not appear in the simulation. So we will be stopping at milepost 27.5, which is where Exton would be today, but it would not be simulated, which means we're going to stop randomly on a section of track and pretend it's a station. address the elephant in the room here. That is, the mileposts are counting down to Philadelphia. And now being at 27 miles from Philadelphia, we are pretty much just close enough to be considered in the Philadelphia suburbs. CS64 to the current back of the consist and then reverse direction. So what is the back of the consist? Welcome back. The front of the train has just become the back of the train. And what was on the back of the train, we added an ACS64 power car, which will take us into New York City. We have 2 minutes to go until departure. Okay, we've connected in for 11,000 volt power, although in modern times it's upgraded to 12,000 volts. Which will propel us along our journey to the highest speeds we're going to see on the entire route.
South at HP 34, over. One car on 75. I'm a car.
Okay, it's departure time. Next station is Trenton, New Jersey at 15:56. So Philadelphia is a large northeast city, and large northeast cities are built on the fall line because they could use waterfalls for hydroelectric power. Because we're on the fall line, that means we are transitioned to the coastal plain. We are now off the Piedmont and on the last physiographic region before reaching the Atlantic Ocean. Now, the coastal plain does have two levels. It has an upper coastal plain and a lower coastal plain. We are on the upper coastal plain and will actually never go onto the lower coastal plain because it folds into the Atlantic Ocean roughly where Mattawan, New Jersey is. Heading back the direction we came, funny enough, going back into Zoo Interlocking, but this time we're going to be going the other way to stay on the Northeast Corridor. So just for geography, that's where we came from, Philadelphia, and then even earlier than that, we came from the Harrisburg, the line to Harrisburg, which is that way. And this way goes to New York City, and those strange animals you were hearing is the Philadelphia Zoo, which is why this is called Zoo Interlocking. Crossing the Schuylkill River. Thank you. pursuing or locking? So speeds are finally going up to mainline speeds. And then once past Frankfurt Junction, we will go high speed. Philadelphia Station, and in the past, Pennsylvania Railroad used to board trains westward here. So if we were operating as the Duquesne, we would have originated from this station. Outbound. No, it's an approach limited. Okay, no. The track switches at Philadelphia, so we're actually on track 4. So I was correct. Okay, and limited approach. The signaling is much better on the NEC than it is on the Pittsburgh line so far. Drivers in the Northeast tend to drive really fast, but let me tell you, I have never seen someone driving 94 miles an hour. I guess I have seen a few people drive that fast, but I have never seen an entire lane driving that fast. Okay, triple digits for the first time on our journey. Thank you. believe we're receiving a restricting signal because of the distance to the next signal, and OpenRails just isn't looking that far ahead. I believe I saw that before, and it clears the closer you get to it. Thank you. favorite lake. And in just a couple miles, we'll be crossing the Delaware into New Jersey. This is pretty incredible. You know, when we started, it was dark out, and now the sun is starting to change the color of the sky in the evening. And that's insane, the amount of time that this has taken. Okay, now despite the fact that the speed limit up ahead says 70, we don't need to worry about that. It's one of those situations where the interlocking has been rerouted to allow for faster travel. So although in real, you know, if this were realistic, we would have derailed. That doesn't happen now because of our situation of being in the present time. Okay, as it says, we are crossing the Delaware right now. And entering Trenton. Wow, first time we're early. Full 5 minutes early at that. Well, we'll be holding here for roughly the next 5 minutes. So it's starting to get really, really late in the day, that sort of time of the day when OpenRails starts changing funny colors and we get a circle sunset. Yeah, we'll call it that. It's like a clown vomited in the sky. Okay, we are departing Trenton. will be making a rush even longer than the Acela does through this section here, all the way out to Newark, New Jersey. We're due there at 4:38, and we're going to discharge passengers only. Which makes sense, because, you know, we're just going 10 miles. What's the point of transporting people on a long-distance train 10 miles? When we started, it was dark out, and we're getting really close to sunset. I've done a lot in Train Simulator, and I've done a lot of times, but I don't think I have ever gone sundown to sundown through an entire day in a Train Simulator. I do not think, not once have I ever done that. That will be a personal first. But we're not there yet, so we'll have to see on that one. This is the fastest, longest stretch that we're going to be on this entire trip, starting now. I can't believe that OpenRails, for as long as it's existed, hasn't designed a better environment simulator. I will pay for a sky mod if we can just, you know, get it to act realistically. You know, instead of changing yellow on the sun and red everywhere else, it's only red in the last moments of sunset. And generally, when there's clouds in the sky. If there's not clouds in the sky, there's not enough relay scattering active to change the sun any more than deep orange when it goes down. If you're over water, then you might see red. Awesome. I'm glad he made it because, man, oh man, we hit the first guy at like what? 70? Hitting a deer at 125 would definitely double the kinetic energy. I think if you hit one at 70, if you go 100, that will basically double your kinetic energy. So we'd have like three times the kinetic energy in hitting a deer at this speed. Yeah, I never understand this. It's like the sky is pink everywhere, except here, where it's, what is that, like salmon? The sky never, ever does that. Over here, it should be deep blue. And then near the sun, white. And even nearer the sun, yellow. And then the sun itself might be orange. How to make it all better. We're driving a train across a platform on Jupiter. And we're looking up at some ammonium hydro... Okay, I can't even explain that. I was gonna say, we can try pretending that this is ammonium hydrosulfide clouds, but they can't just immediately turn yellow like that. Have a lot of capability in space, but definitely the one place I wouldn't see them operating would be the atmospheres of gas giants. That is pretty much exclusively airship and perhaps submarine zones, if anyone was crazy enough to go there. I mean, there's nothing but air. Well, there's not even air. There's nothing but, like, hydrogen there. So unless you're running out of hydrogen, there's basically no reason to go there. And because the atmosphere is full of hydrogen, it means that hydrogen airships don't even work. So you basically have to heat the air. So in other words, it would be a hot air airship. Okay, enough space talk for my train video. We'll leave that kind of thing to my space videos. Brunswick is pretty much the end of our run. There are a couple curves coming up that we're going to have to slow down to when we get to Edison. This is the Raritan River. Guys, I haven't said this before because I always thought it sounded, you know, really annoying to you know, self-promote stuff. It's kind of like an advertisement, which is extremely annoying. But I am trying to do it, and I've heard that for the most part it works. So guys, if you enjoy my channel, if you don't mind subscribing, that would be awesome. I am trying to grow it, so... to help me out, that'd be awesome. That's all I'm gonna say. Okay, this curve 90, the next one's 80. this is normally where everybody would be stopping for Metro Park, but because we're not a commuter train but a long distance train, we're going to blow right past it. And by the way, that's the Menlo Park station you see, which is not the same as the Metro Park station. The name was changed and the station was moved between then and now. Now, normally I don't have to worry about these curves, and I feel like time is moving in fast motion because, like I said, everybody stops at Metro Park, and this is one of the very few times I've run past it. Now, one time I skipped Metro Park was for the Acela Express direct. I think it was straight NEC to Washington, not even stopping for Philadelphia, which I thought was crazy, but apparently it's something that Amtrak wants to keep doing, so we'll see what happens once everybody goes back to the rails. It's going to be close. Don't quite know if the sun's going to set by the time we reach New York City. Careful here, because we're getting close to the Elizabeth S curve, and normally we'd be at a slower speed moving over because of Metro Park, but having not stopped there, we're blowing by Union at full speed. You have to use Union in this game to reach Menlo Park because the interlockings that serve Metro Park were not installed in the 1950s when this route was simulated. Okay, Lyndon, that's my warning sign. And I think I can see the S-curve coming up ahead. Have 8 miles to go, and we're due in 22 minutes, so there's basically no chance that we're going to be late now. It's very strange. My schedule runs slow on the Harrisburg line and fast on the NEC, so I'm not sure what changes occurred between then and the speed schedule that I have. Okay, not bad. Yep, this is Elmora. Perfect. We just about nailed that. The only way I could have done that better was to do it in a single brake, which is pretty risky. This part of the curve, we can go a little bit faster. This is the last time we're going to break triple digits. Ooh, we're getting really close. I'm not 100% sure, but I think we might have a sunset in Newark. Guys, that's it. So it wasn't here at the time, but nowadays the Newark Liberty International Airport station is here. It is between this green bridge that's coming up ahead and the next one. But we don't stop here. Okay, so right now we would be going through the station. City suburbs, but coming up on the left is the outermost rapid transit system for New York City. I'm not counting New Jersey Transit as a rapid transit system because it doesn't run at the same frequency that subways do. But the PATH train does, which stands for Port Authority Trans-Hudson. And this is its tracks starting right here. Its first station is Newark Penn Station, in the exact same structure and really trackage that we'll be on, although the PATH trains are separated. PATH trains always stay on PATH tracks, and Amtrak's always stay on Amtrak tracks. Same with New Jersey Transit. But the tracks are interlocked. Okay, 1624. And we're due at 38. So 14-minute wait would be what we would typically have to do. Now, there's a note here that the train says stops only to discharge passengers. Train may leave before time shown. I like that they do that. We'll talk a little bit more about that when we depart. But that basically means that we get to depart as soon as our passengers have discharged. So we'll wait just a minute here. Okay, so my quick spiel about the schedules. Amtrak used to publish a large book that it would be called the System Timetable, and it includes all the schedules for every train line that Amtrak runs. Then, starting around 2018, they got rid of the System Timetable, and they instead did route-by-route timetables. So now the Acela has its own timetable. The Empire Builder has its own timetable. Now, these have existed in the past, but what's different is the system timetable never existed. But then in 2020, starting with the pandemic, they have discontinued even those schedules. And now the only way to see the times that the trains leave and depart stations are by planning a trip using the trip planner. You can't even tell what time the train gets to intermediate stations. It will only tell you your boarding station and your arrival station. And I am glad that, like me, there are many potential passengers and enthusiasts who are frustrated with this fact for multiple reasons. One, if you're a train spotter, you don't know when the train's going to come through, so you can't plan it. Two, if you're trying to board the train, but trying to determine what the most economical schedule is for you and not what some computer says, because they don't understand everything that you're taking into account, you can't see that. You can't see the individual trains and the individual station to determine which station is the best to board for you. Third, if you're riding the train, you can't see what time the train is going to be at various stations. This means that if you were planning to meet somebody, or if you were planning to see something trackside, it's now going to become an unknown. Along with, you don't know where the train is going to stop. So if I'm riding Empire Builder, and I want to see the entrance to the Rocky Mountains and pay attention outside the window and look at Mariah's Pass, or as we go over it, I won't know what time we come up to Mariah's Pass because the schedule is not published. So I'm really hoping that when everybody comes back to the rails, Amtrak will start publishing schedules again, because if this is like the new normal, it's going to be incredibly frustrating for train enthusiasts who actually want to ride the trains for fun instead of it just being like another airline. So maybe there is a private schedule that I just don't know about, but as far as I know, there is no published way to view it. And I am very frustrated, and a lot of people apparently are also frustrated. Okay, this is the last time we will get a sound changeover on this trip. So the PATH train, along with New Jersey Transit line to Hoboken, is down there. And we're going to go up onto a flyover as those tracks go underneath towards Jersey City. So those those tracks lead in towards Jersey City. Actually, I forgot. This is the next to last time that we're going to cause a sound changeover. There will be one more time. Nope. We're probably going to get to New York City right at sunset. And that's Interstate 95. Okay. Something about the moon here. You can't have a moon that's illuminated on one side. You would expect the sun to be there, but it's actually there. So if the sun is there and the moon is there, that means there has to be a full moon. So unfortunately the sky is really messed up in OpenRails. Really hope that gets fixed, because that it makes it so much harder for me to get into it, because I pay attention to stuff like that. That's why I enjoy driving trains at sunset so many times, is because it's fun to see the room transform from day until night. Okay, passing through the ever diminishing marshlands. And right through here, we'll be passing through the Secaucus Junction Station, which again is a new station that didn't exist at the time this route was simulating. And as we reach the Bergen approach interlocking, it's time to decelerate for the last time. That is a nice view. The sun is coming straight down the vector of the railroad. Yeah, pretty much sunset right now, the entire day. Amazing. Okay, well, we're going to end our trip in our final tunnel here. This is the North River Tunnels. manipulate the HUD here so that we can see our camera, you will see that we are reaching the lowest elevation of the entire journey. Doesn't look like the camera's quite reading out right now. Yeah, it's saying it's at 0 meters, but that's not true. We're actually almost 100 feet below sea level right now as we leave New Jersey and enter New York State. A couple of years ago, this window to the sky was covered up to make room for Hudson Yards. It is no longer here, which means that this is a tunnel all the way into New York and the station. Let's do a quick sun check. We are right on the horizon, the middle limb of the sun. So, depending on how you define sunset, it's either about to happen or in the halfway done. Okay, and this is the furthest distance that you can drive in the Pennsylvania Railroad version 2 route, nonstop. There are lots of other lines that I have been down, and there are even more lines that I have not been down. This route is almost endless. So that's it. We are discharging passengers at 16:38, which is the time that we were originally scheduled to be at Newark, and we are 20 minutes early at our final destination. And this is the final stop of train 42. We've taken it from its origination station all the way to the destination. So this is the entire trip of Pennsylvania train 42. I've been Dr. Aeronautics. Thank you guys for joining me, and I will see you guys next time. Bye-bye.